Hi, everybody, and welcome to the summer edition of the Indulge Fest. Today, we are exploring a confluence of food and design, and we are going to be touching upon the topic of kitchen design. So, its craft, the nuances, and basically everything it takes to create sort of, you know, a cooking haven for homeowners. Our speakers today are two of India's foremost architects. We have Pashmin Shah, who runs Amoeba Design in Pune with her partner Satyajit Patwardhan. Their approach to their work is very organic. So you'll see a lot of you'll see use of light and texture and materials, and this combination gives their projects a very cultural and contextual very hard hitting impact. Also on the panel is Sahil Parikh. He is one half of We Design Studio, which is a Mumbai-based design studio that he runs with his wife, Nupur Shah. With Sahil, his projects are, you'll notice a seamlessness. There's minimalism, but it's very, very high on functionality. So there is this balance of restraint and richness, which, gives their work a very strong, timeless aesthetic. Thank you both for taking the time out and joining us today.
Our pleasure, Tina.
You all have very distinct design styles, and you'll have worked on small and large projects, across the board. But today we want to talk about a very, very specific room of the house, which is the kitchen. It's the most high traffic zone in a residence. Movement is seen there throughout the day. So, to begin, if you all could help us understand what it is that the Indian homeowner is looking for and needs, in their kitchen in terms of design. Pashmin, if you would like to start.
Yeah, sure. See, I would say post-COVID, things have really changed. And it's changed for good. I mean, people have spent a lot of time in the homes. And they have realized, kitchen is actually quite the most important part. And so nowadays, after the post-COVID, then even during client discussions, the men of the family are equally involved in designing the kitchen. So I think everybody is really interested in the type of kitchen they want. Yeah. It's just like us, they want traditional, but at the same time, it's very contemporary approach. So I think they are looking for a very open space. Open in a way, it's more of a communal space now. I mean, the dining part has kind of extended a little bit in the kitchen. I think it's really communal. That's the best way to put it.
Okay. Sahil, have you noticed something similar?
I completely agree with Pashmin here that I think for the longest time, the kitchen was always part of the service spaces and, never really in the foreground per se. But I think over a period of time, things have changed. A lot of cross migration. The younger generation, a lot of them like to cook themselves and experiment with food. So the kitchen has become as critical, if not more, as important a part as the living and the dining spaces. So more and more focus on the kitchen, yes, for sure.
Okay. And is this a change that, you all are noticing? Is this a recent change, or have you all been seeing it over, the last decade? Or how have things changed, if we were to look at the last decade?
Honestly, you want to go ahead, Sahil?
No, please. I'll follow you always.
No, I was just saying, what has happened is, in India, more and more, at least in the cities, the family size have shrunk. And, it's either 3 max or 4, over the top. And I think, and that's the reason people are not wanting to have closed houses or closed kitchens. So they are preferring more of open kitchens. And I think it has been changing pre-COVID also. Like, at least with whatever clients we have got, I have rarely had anybody saying that, I want a closed kitchen, unless and until it's a family of 12 or 15, where they really want to cut off the kitchens. Yeah. So I think it has been changed, but recently the major change is like everybody in the house wants to cook, and that's why everybody is involved in the kitchen design, because everybody has a different requirement or a different part of the kitchen that they want to look into. So I think that has changed, but it has been changing pre-COVID, I feel.
Okay. So what you're saying is, you know, the fact that they want open kitchens, it's now become a part of the public spaces of the house in terms of, you know, sometimes not just family members, but even if you have guests over, there's that sort of intermingling that happens in the kitchen often, you know, when people are entertaining.
Yeah. So kitchen, dining and living, it's all spilling over spaces, you know.
Yeah, correct. Okay. Sahil, go for it.
To answer your question, yes. Now, we've been practicing for about a decade. And this is not a change that's happened over the last year or so, but we've been sort of noticing this, the kitchen has been given a lot of importance, I think, over the last decade, ever since we started practicing and working for ourselves. As far as the open versus closed kitchen goes, I guess it really depends on the kind of space you have available play with. We do, by virtue of being in Mumbai, we do a lot of projects in Mumbai, and unfortunately or fortunately, you know, the apartment, everybody knows how compact the apartments tend to be in a city like Bombay. So I have a few personal reservations about open plan kitchens, because, you know, Indian food being the way it is, it's messy, the smells. It's rather difficult to not have those smells travel to the rest of the house when the kitchen is open. But at the same time, yes, a certain seamless connect is always nice to have. But a completely open kitchen is something that we have yet to explore in at least in Bombay-based projects.
Okay. So you see more of closed kitchens then?
Yeah, unless there's more than one kitchen, when there's more than, so there is the concept of the wet and dry kitchen, where you have your primary kitchen, you know, where food is being prepared all the time, which is a closed space. But there is a secondary sort of open plan kitchen, which allows for interaction with the dining and the living areas, but that's more for once in a while preparations, relatively, less messier preparations, things like that. That works wonderfully well.
Okay. Pashman, you mentioned something about how everybody is now sort of interested in cooking and they all want to be part of how the kitchen is designed. But, every individual has a very specific way of how they move around the kitchen, how they use it. So, even within one family. How do you then bring in that balance of, every individual's needs and create sort of that holistic space?
See, it's when I say everybody is involved, the majority of them, they are depending on the gadgets that they want in the kitchen. Like, one would be more about, I need an oven to bake something. So I would say, because since it's a very functional space, your movement is very important in the kitchen.
Yeah.
So it depends on the size, generally the three-point, the triangle works best. We separate the preparation area, we separate the cooking area, and then the storage area. So that way, it almost helps everybody, because and that the triangle also works, and then you have a central platform if the space allows. If not, then we can always have like a small moving cart, that can be used, because when everybody's involved. Like, it only happens during some times of the week or months, honestly. Right. Otherwise, majority of the time, it's like only one person cooking in the kitchen. Correct. So a little flexibility, I think, is very important in the planning.
Okay. So, Sahil, Pashman mentioned, this use of gadgets coming in. what is that like in India in terms of, you know, very high tech appliances, smart appliances? How has that sort of evolved in with Indian kitchens now? Is that coming in more and more?
Yes, absolutely. I think at this point in time, what most people would usually want, in addition to your basic, you know, refrigerator and hob and smoke extractor, you're definitely looking at a wine cooler. You're definitely looking at a nice built-in oven microwave. The taste palette has evolved as well. So people are willing to spend on better quality appliances. And the technology has improved considerably over the last decade, I would say. Markets have obviously opened up considerably as well. So what was not available or what was available at a very, very premium price 10 years ago has become a lot more affordable today.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, you know, I also want to touch upon the core design aspect of kitchen. So when you all are designing a kitchen, you know, after you've spoken to the client, you know exactly what they want. How do you bring into consideration, you know, the materials that you're using, the colors, the textures, all of that, you know, considering that there's food spillage, there's, you know, movement throughout the day. How do you go about, you know, those very important considerations with the kitchen? Any one of you all can.
Pashmin, you want to go first?
Sure. I would say this is a very, it's a very person-specific things about the materials. I mean, we generally tend to use, it's more like budget-friendly materials, which are easy to maintain. So, but again, at some points there are people who would want to use wood in the kitchen, or, you know, so it's really personal, but I would prefer that, you know, nowadays you get very strong stones, which are like quartz. Granite is all time favorite. Like if you want more colors in the kitchen. So I think quartz is something that it really helps. Again, colors, I prefer to have colorful kitchen. I'm really, because I think people spend a lot of time in kitchens. If it generates a good mood, if there's good lighting in the kitchen, I think it helps. It helps in making the day much better. So I would like, I've used a lot of painted kitchens also. I mean, you just need to be a little careful while cleaning it. That's about it. I mean, I don't think so there is any other maintenance issues with it, other than the regular laminated surfaces.
Okay. But do you see more and more people requesting for colorful kitchens now?
I mean, for with me, yes. I mean, we do a lot of customization. You know, like if you see the comparison with modular kitchens, you know, we have very rarely used modular kitchens before. But now even they are offering a lot of customization. So we have tried exploring that options. But otherwise, people tend to, nowadays I have hardly used any kind of wooden kitchen, you know, just to give you an example. And that will show like why people are asking for so many colorful kitchens for some reason. So I think it just helps have a good vibe to the house. Again, it's very personal specific. It's very client specific. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are people who want white kitchens. So, and which I adore at the same time.
Okay. Sahil, do you have, maybe material preferences or something like that?
Yeah, I would beg to differ slightly.
I knew he was going to say that.
Because we use incredible amount of restraint when it comes to color. The availability of artificial stones has helped us a lot. 10, 15 years ago, all we had were natural granites to sort of work with as far as the countertops are concerned, but huge range of artificial stones and quartzites are available now. So plenty of opportunity to work with different colors to begin with. And most of them are fit and forget. So you don't really have to worry about maintenance or staining or any such things, or wear and tear for that matter. As far as the cabinets are concerned, we have worked with a lot of pure teak wood drawer fascias and shutter fascias, and they're all finished naturally, either with a linseed oil or a matte PU, which is fairly fit and forget, but quite hardy in that sense. So fairly easy to maintain. Even the staining and all is usually not a problem, but for incredibly large families where the wear and tear is very high, definitely work with a PU or even stainless steel for that matter, because from a hygiene point of view, nothing works as well as stainless steel. More often than not, we end up building the kitchens ourselves, because it's a cost versus quality balance that most clients look for. Mm-hmm. But currently, we are working with companies like Bullthorpe and Bogan Pole, great stuff, great options available there.
Mm-hmm. And Sahil, do you see do you find that there's more customization happening with kitchens, or are modular kitchens working just as well for Indian homes?
They do. Modular doesn't necessarily mean that no customization.
Yeah, exactly.
They do.
Yeah.
Within a certain framework, there is a lot of flexibility available.
Correct.
Yes, there are certain limitations with brands like these modular kitchens. But I think plenty of opportunities to customize as well.
Okay. And both work equally well with Indian homes and the Indian style of cooking and all of that.
Yes, they do. I think more and more people are now opting for very, very high level of customization when it comes to each drawer, the way each jar needs to be stored. So in that sense, modular kitchens offer sort of great levels of customization in that sense,
Right. Okay. Pashman, I'm going to, turn to you now. Sahil mentioned that, a lot of the projects they work on in Bombay, you have the problem of, maybe not a problem, but, you have compact sizes and you have to work within what you have. Like the rest of Indian homes, our biggest requirement is storage. So, when you're designing the kitchen, how do you bring all of that, storage, the compact size, trying to make it, budget friendly and within whatever budget the client has? How do you, make sure that every need is brought into the kitchen within those limitations?
I think the first thing we generally do, I prefer is I break down all the walls in the kitchen. Because those 6 inches of wall takes up a lot of space, I feel.
Yeah.
And that is the best way to start with. It depends on the planning also. If kitchen is next to, say, for example, half of the time it's next to the dining area or a passage. So if it is around the passage, you just break down that complete wall. You open up the kitchen, you have the storage top and below. In the middle, you can have like a small slit or something. And at the same time, all the corners, nowadays dishwasher is a must have in all the homes. Everybody's asking us for that. So the corners actually go very well with these kind of appliances, because I generally tend to put them in the corners and use them from the other side.
Okay.
So either it could be from the passage, it could be from the dining area, and it will be concealed. So it's not really visible. So that way we try to maximize even every inch of the kitchen.
Sahil, how do you work with when
I
you have
totally
compact?
Agree with Pashmin there. Planning and Indians are all about storage.
Yeah.
So if no one doesn't want storage.
Yeah.
In a nutshell, yeah. So I completely agree with Pashmin there that planning is very critical. Before You move things to site. It's always useful to plan things on paper to the T, run it by the clients, you know, get them to sign off. Best way, most efficient way of kind of going about it and ensuring that every inch of space is utilized to maximum capacity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Could you tell us about maybe a project that y'all have worked on where, you know, the kitchen has been, maybe you remember the kitchen very well because maybe it was challenging or that it turned out really well or you had to turn things upside down for, you know, for the client. Any specific kitchen incidents that have happened to y'all?
I mean, I have had many with the colors, I would say. Okay. Honestly, because fortunately we have got many clients who really wanted to play with colors. But other than that, we never really turned upside down because we really planned the kitchens quite well in time. Mm-hmm. I think colors were the only thing where we did a lot of work.
So convincing the client for color, is that what you're saying?
No, I mean, it's just having those small arguments about the color, finalizing the colors, you know.
Okay.
Other than that, not really. Actually, I can't think of anything that space-wise, if anybody, like, there was any issue.
Okay. Sahil?
You know, one problem we sort of face very often and pretty much every project, at least in Bombay, is this whole issue of piped gas. And it's a nightmare, really, to work with, with the government organization, and you know, you plan your kitchens beautifully and they look stunning, all's good until these guys come in with their pipes running all the way, you know, across, because they don't let you conceal these pipes.
Yeah,
so that's a nightmare for us, and it's just something that is really, really difficult to resolve because there just doesn't seem to be a workaround to this particular problem. And it's a practical requirement. People prefer the use of pipe gas as opposed to the, you know, the LPG portable cylinders. So that is something, you know, it's more a practical kind of problem that we face and how best to keep it as discreet as possible. I mean, you know, yeah, nothing really specific jumps to mind per se.
Yeah.
Okay. And, you know, one thing I wanted to, you know, just quickly understand is when you all are designing the kitchen, do you make that attempt to tie it aesthetically with the theme of the rest of the home, or is the kitchen sort of, you know, its own space, and because its needs are, you know, so sort of, it's so multifunctional that it needs its own aesthetic?
You know my answer. I mean,
no, but you have to say it anyway.
No-brainer. Pashmin, please go ahead. I'll follow.
No, I really think it can't be one space, you know, on its own. It has to tie in with the rest of the house. Because every space is a continuation of the house. Every space identifies the people who stay in the house. Mm-hmm. So I really think it should be the continuation of the overall theme.
Okay. So you do try and tie it together with every room. Okay.
Yeah, same.
I mean, same. A certain cohesiveness that runs through the house. And yes. Your material palette is one way of bringing that about. So certain continuity is important, at least in my opinion.
Okay. Okay, you know, I want to touch upon one last thing. As designers, for you, what are the cornerstones of good kitchen design? Like, you know, things that you have to take into consideration when you're designing a kitchen. Pashmin.
I would say the most important thing is to sit down with the client and make that list. Like, you know, storage-wise, how much storage is needed?
Yeah.
Like nowadays, like just recent times, there are people who say, I don't want a lot of storage in the kitchen.
Mm-hmm.
So there are either cases. So I think it's really important to list down the appliances also. what all is needed, because many a times if you consider if these things are last minute, you know, it creates a hustle with everything, with the practical things. But I think storage one, the use, who is going to use the kitchen? That is very important. You know, is the family going to use? Are the helpers going to use? You know, how, and that will decide on a lot of material selection and a lot of hardware selection. Because we generally, I mean, at least I generally ask the clients, you know, like, you know, you spend in the kitchen, especially in the hardware, because that is something which is going to be used day and night.
Mm-hmm.
So even if it is not visible, I mean, it's really important part of the house. So yeah, these certain things are very important to finalize beforehand, so that, you know, then the designing of the kitchen is really easy that way.
Okay. Okay. Sahil?
Yeah, I mean, to a large extent, I agree with Pashmin again that knowing what the client's needs are is quite important. It helps when there is a lot of clarity in each client's head as to what their requirements are. What is it that they're looking at spending on the kitchen is also a fairly important question to ask early on, which mm-hmm. again helps us guide them in a better way. Once you have a certain amount of clarity on the cost and who it is that is using the kitchen, it helps you kind of plan all your appliances, storage, the kind of hardware, finishes, etc. So a one-on-one interaction with each client at the start of the project is fairly useful. That's where I think where most of us would begin.
Yeah. Okay. And do you when you are making your suggestions to your clients, when you're having this, you know, this discussion with them, how do budgets feature? Do you tell them not to scrimp on the budget too much when it comes to the kitchen, or is it fine to work within a tight budget when it comes to the kitchen?
Well, I think budget is really important, you know, because that is how you will select things, or, you know, suggest what to do, especially with the hardware and all. See, I mean, if you have a good budget, then go with the modular ones. If the client is required, but I think majority of the times it's like, you know, mix of both. I mean, we customize a lot. So, So hardware. I'm sorry, I completely forgot what I was saying.
No, that's fine. So you were talking about how you do a mix of customization.
Again, what Pashmin said, that you need to balance everything out at the end of the day. People are, you know, clients are willing to spend, but even with high budget projects, there is still a budget. Unfortunately, one of the perils of a profession is there tends to be no ceiling limit as to how much one can spend. So everything needs to be budgeted out, and you can create great value by balancing, a large part of it you build yourself, but at the same time you can use very good quality appliances and hardware, drawer dividers, things like that. So it's a good balance to strike between economy versus the quality that you achieve, you know.
Right. Okay. I think that wraps up everything I wanted to discuss today. Thank you so much for taking the time out and joining us. I know there are very, very busy schedules going around these days. But thank you.
Pleasure, Tina. And thank you for having us.
Yeah, absolutely. Seriously, thank you for having us.
Yeah, I hope we meet really soon, not just virtually.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Look forward to it.
All right. See you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.